Thank you for being here, and thank you to Anthony and to Ari for hosting us. We're really excited to be here tonight. So I'm going to get us started. So the kind of natural place to start is why this book? What is the purpose of the book, and why did we think now was a good time for it? And so we know that our current political climate and criminal justice climate is one in which we hear a lot of conversations about race and crime. But what we started noticing is that the conversations tended to be focused on black and or brown people and whites. So oftentimes police brutality, white police brutality against communities of color. But what seems to be absent in that conversation are communities of color, specifically the Asian American or the Asian community. And so questions that we started asking are, do Asian Americans commit crimes? Yes, of course. And are they the victims of crimes? Yes, they are. And are they the victims of unjust criminal justice practices? Certainly they are as well. And so while we certainly wouldn't argue that Asian Americans face the same, necessarily the same type or severity of police maltreatment, we believe that there's a lot to be learned from the model minorities' treatment within the criminal justice system. So adding to that, we both study Asian Americans from a deviance and conformity standpoint, and we both study Asian Americans as the model minority. So the plan for today is I will begin by sharing some findings from the project that Anthony mentioned, which is my book project, which is hopefully out in fall 2017. And this stems from my dissertation research. So I thought it would be good for me to tell you a little bit about the project that inspired the book that we're focusing on today. And so I'll be talking about chapter 9, Telling Their Stories, which features in-depth interviews with Asian American undergraduates at Virginia Tech after two horrific crimes that happened there. We'll then both discuss the organization and the focus of today's book. And then Nicholas is going to share findings from his chapter, Aldo Kim and the Specter of Academic Failure, which is featured in the book that we're focused on today. And then we'll have time for questions and book signing. So, my work on my dissertation project is what generated my interest in Asian American criminal justice involvement in general. And so I'm going to talk today about Chapter 9, which I entitled Telling Their Stories. So I want to get us started by setting the stage. We're all familiar, I believe, with the massacre that occurred at Virginia Tech. Would that be accurate? Right. So Sungwi Cho, Korean American, killed 32 people, wounded 17 others, and then he took his own life. A crime happened about a year and a half later on the same campus. There was a beheading on campus, and I'm just curious in the audience, how many of you had heard about this beheading? Okay, so I see one hand up. And that's not surprising. When I give this talk, I find that everybody's heard about the shooting, but very few people have heard about the Hyung Zoo case. So I'll tell you just a little bit about it so that you have some background information. Hyung Zoo was a Chinese graduate student at the time at Virginia Tech, and he had been paired with Yin Yang, an incoming graduate student also from China, to be somewhat of her mentor or her buddy, essentially, to show her around the campus. And so they'd only known each other for about 2 weeks. Over that time, he developed apparently romantic feelings for her. And so he asked her to meet for coffee in the Album Pan Cafe. Talk about globalization, right? So we have this Album Pan Cafe on the Virginia Tech campus in Blacksburg. And he expressed his romantic feelings to her, and she declined. And at that point, he pulled out a large kitchen knife and chopped her head off. And so the media reports were that when the police arrived, they found him in the foreground holding her head by her hair, and then her body in the background. So really, really horrific crime, but it's very interesting, isn't it, that we all know about the massacre, but very few of us have heard about the beheading. And so I'm just going to show you some images. This is Cho in school, and then Cho in his manifesto that he shared with NBC News. Then there was, of course, lots of memorials and mourning on campus at Virginia Tech, and then also this, for example, a memorial parade in Seoul, and then even Time Magazine memorializing the victims, etc. And then here, there are very few images of Hyung Zoo and his victim, but here are just a few, him in court, an image of the crime scene, and then a photo of before the crime occurred of him from his Facebook page. All right, so this leads me to my central question. So we find that both crimes were horrific, both were highly visible, And in both cases, the perpetrator was of Asian descent. So the questions that I'm posing in this project are, what happens when a positive stereotype bumps into or crosses paths with a negative stereotype? So we know that Asian Americans are commonly cast as the model minority. So what happens when they're then framed under a different stereotype, that of criminal threat, one which they're not commonly framed under, at least in this era? So what I believe we can learn here is what strategies do racial minorities take when combating these two very different types of stereotypes, and or when given the choice between one more or less positive stereotype, do they cling on to the more positive one, even if the literature states that it is detrimental to them, such as the Asian American, such as the model minority stereotype. So I want to take us a few steps back, and I want to tell you about a project that I did on campus to gauge campus climate. And I'm going to explain what desktop graffiti is for those of you who haven't seen it. Has anybody studied at a place where on the desks there was writing, graffiti, carving in the desks? This is something you're familiar with. Okay. So as a graduate student at Virginia Tech, I was interested in using graffiti as an unobtrusive measure to study campus climate. So naturally, if I were to ask, you know, do you have racist sentiments towards this group or that, on a survey or an interview, perhaps people wouldn't be forthcoming. But maybe there's something to be found from the doodles that people make while they're sitting there in class, some sort of subconscious thing coming up from the graffiti. And so what I did is I conducted a content analysis. I'm a sociologist and a criminologist, and so I did a content analysis, and I collected graffiti, I digitally photographed it, and this landed, this resulted in about 1,700 pieces of graffiti that I analyzed and categorized. And having been at the university, I expected to find hostile graffiti, anti-African-American graffiti on the part of presumably white student authors. With any study like this, of course, we can't know who is sitting in the desk and penning the graffiti, but I have analyzed it in relation to who was registered for classes and who had classes in those rooms and what the race of the instructor was, et cetera, to see what connections I could make. So what I found was the most popular theme of the graffiti was Virginia Tech, so support for the university. The school mascot is the Hokie bird, which is a fictionalized turkey. Mm-hmm. And so there was tons of support for the university. Go Hokies, the VT symbol. The second most popular theme was sex. The third was Greek organizations, and so by that I mean fraternities and sororities. And then fourth, drugs, so drawings of marijuana leaves, joints being burned, etc. One of the least common themes, and this surprised me, was racist graffiti, but what I found is that each of the pieces that I found targeted Asians or Asian Americans. So for example, I found one piece that said Koreans eat dog, another that said Chinese go home, go back on the boat, etc. And I should note that Asian American is the largest racial minority group at the university. So perhaps what this is arguing is that the sentiments are most harsh towards the largest racial minority group in a given setting. So I'm going to show you just a few photos of what this graffiti looks like. And these are, in some cases, in none of these photos is the entire desk, so this is just a zoomed image of what we're interested in. So this is a handgun, and it says boom boom, bong thug. This says, no fat chicks, the guys hate gays. And then this is a fraternity emblem that's then turned into gay, so KA becomes gay. And the VT symbol several times. In this case, we have an homage to 420, getting high. Fuck it all, give war a chance. And then a lot of messages where students throughout the day would respond to what somebody who had sat in that desk previously was saying. And one thing that I want to note is that the desks are cleaned every semester, so I was able to identify a general time period for when the graffiti was written. And so in the project that I'll be discussing today, what we find is what I did is I analyzed the graffiti post and or pre and post the crimes. And then finally, man wearing a Virginia Tech hat, and then fag written pointed to him. OK, Okay, so I want to bring us back to the aftermath of the crimes. So after April 16th, and then again after the beheading, what we found in the climate, both on campus and in the community, was a very harsh anti-Asian, anti-Asian American climate, anti-Asian rhetoric. And so, for example, you'd see people with signs in their yards or people writing on blogs saying things such as, Virginia Tech should no longer allow international students to study here. You see, this is why the school should only be open to white students. We shouldn't allow international graduate students. We shouldn't allow anybody but white male students. The term crazian, which is crazy and Asian combined, was something that you saw a lot of. And so it got to such a point, such an uncomfortable degree, that the university president at the time wrote an open letter to the campus community. And so he's saying, these are his exact words. So he says, I want to address troubling commentary. It's important to note that the international student community has an outstanding law-abiding history and reputation. He goes on to say, our international students are extremely underrepresented in terms of offenses. And then he adds, the Bureau of Justice statistics point out, and that's his phrasing, that Asians are 10 times less likely to commit homicide than whites in the US. And so ostensibly what he's doing is he's trying to say, let's not blame all members of this group for these two crimes that have been committed. But in many people's mind, he actually exacerbated the problem by drawing a link from the criminal threat stereotype to members of this racial minority population. So there are two theoretical frameworks that influence my work. The first is the racial threat thesis, and this is from Blaylock. And this argues that as the relative size of the minority group increases, members of the majority group perceive an increased threat to their power, to their economic security, to them having control of society. And so in response, the majority group takes steps to maintain power. The limitation of the racial threat thesis is that it tends to focus on black on white crime. And so what my work does is it expands it, and it applies this thesis to Asian Americans as both model minority threats and Asian Americans as criminal threats. And when Asian Americans are seen as threats, they're typically seen as an educational or an economic threat, i.e. they'll get spots in universities that white students want to go to, or i.e. they will take the jobs that white potential employers want to secure. And then second, the myth of the model minority from Stacey Lee. And so we know that Asians were recast as the model minority, as a success story, following Peterson's article published in the New York Times Magazine. And so since then, a range of sources have fueled the stereotype, including social scientists. So we are also to blame for fueling this idea that all Asians are Asian Americans are success stories and are bright and successful, and successful both educationally and economically. But at the same time, as a sociologist, we generally agree that the model minority stereotype, even though on its outset it seems positive, it is in fact detrimental to those to whom it's applied. So the current project, I take a mixed methods approach, and so I'll be talking about my findings from my in-depth interviews today. But I also look at campus climate from two other angles. Number one, the content analysis of the graffiti, as I mentioned, and then analysis of campus climate surveys from 1998 up through 2008 to gauge from a variety of angles what campus climate was like and how the crimes affected it for Asian American students. So for my in-depth interviews, I proposed three possible findings. Number one, the idea that Korean and Chinese American, and I'll be clear, just to clarify, I interviewed Korean and Chinese American undergraduates at the university. In order to take part in the study, students had to self-identify as Korean American or as Chinese American. And I chose those two subgroups of Asian American because those are the most populous at the university. So the first possibility is that Korean and Chinese American undergraduates would work to combat stereotypes linked to the model minority. So if much of the literature says the model minority stereotype is detrimental, perhaps these students would work against it or combat it. Second possibility is that they would actively work to distance themselves from the horrific crimes. And so what we see is that in the community, there's all of this conversation about the threat that Asian American students are causing to the community. So perhaps they would push back against that. And then third possibility is that perhaps they would work to distance themselves from both stereotypes, maybe replacing the stereotypes with some other image or some other sort of identity work. So for the in-depth interviews, I interviewed 18 Asian American undergraduates at Virginia Tech. Once again, they self-identified as either Korean or Chinese American. I'll talk about the limitations to my project in a few minutes, and one of the central limitations is sample size for this segment of the project. It was incredibly difficult to recruit participants for my study, and I took a number of different approaches to this. I contacted the Asian American Student Union. I went to an Asian American culture show and spoke before 250 people, most of whom were Asian American students, and I asked for their participation in my project. But at a certain point, I felt that I was going to, in terms of timing, I was going to be speaking to people who had experienced kind of a different climate, and so I wanted to keep my interviews within a relative time frame of a year. And I also was hearing in my interviews the same thing over and over, so we refer to that in sociology as theoretical saturation. So I was word for word hearing the same responses from my interviewees. A number of my interviewees double or triple majored, so you'll notice that they're concentrated in STEM fields, but also some majoring in English, finance, marketing, etc., tourism. And I also spoke with people who had been at Virginia Tech when the massacre occurred, and also people who came to the university after it had occurred. And I did that on purpose so that I would get a sense of people who had experienced the aftermath kind of in the moment, and then also people who had experienced it as kind of its legacy went on. So I'm going to talk about findings in four categories. The first is what I refer to as after April, so after the mass shooting. Next, I'll talk about the aftermath of the beheading. Then I'll talk about race on campus and what my respondents said, and then finally about the model minority stereotype. So one interesting thing to note is that following very, very soon after the shooting, the university put into place a ban on any research having to do with the massacre. And so in order to study the massacre, one had to get specific and special IRB approval and had to go through a rigorous process therefore. So my approach in my study, and this might seem counterintuitive, but I decided to not ask about the massacre. So I didn't, that was not one of the things I explicitly asked. And the reason for this is when speaking to people about their time at the university, I thought, well, if this is significant, they're going to bring it up, right? And if they don't bring it up, then it's not a significant part of their narrative, of their story that they're telling me about their time at Tech. And so in all but three cases, it was raised, but surprisingly, it was raised in a very casual manner. And so it was often one of the last things that they brought up, or the kind of least significant things, one of the things they didn't focus on. So I had expected that I would come in and I would be hearing stories about how horrific it had been, or all of the racism that they had faced. And I was generating these expectations based on the president's open letter to the community and what I'd seen in the newspapers and on blogs and letters to the editor. But instead, my respondents seemed very unconcerned with the massacre. So I'm going to share a few excerpts of my interviews with you. So I ask Genji, what about before and after? And so he's somebody who was there, and so he can gauge what things were like before and then following. And he acknowledges, like, at first I was a little bit scared, and I was afraid that I'd be stereotyped, I'd be seen as crazy simply because I was Asian. But then he goes on to say that he experienced nothing like that, that we are all grown-ups, we're all college kids, so we wouldn't kind of stoop that low to be racist or to stereotype people. He goes on to say we're all Hokies, and again, that's the mascot. And so this is something I heard from a number of people, that we're all like one family. He says, oh, I never felt like, oh, Genji, you're Asian, and therefore you're crazy. He says, no, I was a little scared, but in the end, no, nothing. I didn't get any negative feedback. I go on to highlight Kaiser, and I ask, and Kaiser was also here for before and after the massacre. And he characterizes the massacre as a test. And so he says, you know, if you want to know how race relations are on campus specific to the Asian and Asian American community, the massacre was a test of the campus climate. And he also was worried, the first rumor, and you know, not surprisingly, when a crime is committed by a racial minority, often the news highlights the race of the perpetrator in, you know, their first lines about the crime, right? Whereas if it's a white person, that's typically not what's focused on. And so at first the rumor was that the perpetrator he was Chinese. And so Kaiser, who is Chinese American, says, oh no, I was thinking, oh no, it's a Chinese American who did this. And then he switches into a southern accent, and he says, oh, people are going to think, oh, Chinese people, they're weird, you know. And things are going to be different. And then he goes on to say they haven't, that it's a warm community, it's welcoming. And then he adds to that, I've actually never been around people that would discriminate. I've never met people who would make racist jokes. And then he somewhat contradicts himself and says, you know, we all know stereotypes, but they're all very PC or politically correct jokes. Such as, oh, help me fix my printer. And he says this is something he's experienced not only at Virginia Tech, but kind of throughout his life. So moving along to the beheading, which I call the GLC incident, simply because the concept of beheading is unpleasant. So very few respondents mentioned the GLC incident, but there was not a ban on asking about that at the university. So I did ask, what do you know about it? Do you know about it? All respondents did know about it, but they knew very few details. And so here are some representative examples. So I ask Orion, what did you hear about it? And he says, oh, I heard a Chinese guy pulled out like a Chinese cooking knife and chopped off a girl's head. And in ABP, there was a lady who worked there who was so traumatized, she never came back to work. And he goes on to talk about that storyline as opposed to the actual crime that occurred and or any strife that he experienced following the crime. He says it didn't have any impact on him. Similar with Duncan, what about the GLC incident? And he says, ah, yeah, that. And I say, well, was there any backlash? Nope, not terribly. So respondents were very unconcerned. So moving along, race was another thing that I focused on in this project. And so according to my respondents, race did not present a challenge to this group. And this is something that the literature has documented. If and when respondents did note that they had faced stereotype or discrimination, one of the things that they did is they said, oh, but it was all said in fun, or they couched it as a big joke, right? And that, no, it was in no way harmful because people were just playing around. It wasn't really serious. Some of my respondents went on to say that race, we were living in a post-racial society, that race no longer matters or even exists. And they once again characterized themselves as Hokies. So rather than characterizing themselves as members of the Asian American community or Chinese American, they were more likely to say, but I'm a Virginia Tech student, and so is everybody else here. So we're part of the same family. So for example, I asked Genji about experiences related to race. And he says, I have never experienced anything that is racial. Mason says, you know, I'm one of those rare cases. I've never experienced racism for being Asian anywhere. And he says, it's funny, he says at one point he's from the Northeast, and he says, but you know, everybody in the Northeast is like totally politically correct and there's no racism there, so maybe that's why I've never experienced it. And living in Massachusetts myself, you know, of course I know that that's totally inaccurate. I go on to feature Finn. And he says, oh, there's never been a time when I'm walking along campus and I'm saying, I really wish I wasn't Asian right now. So I ask, do you and your friends talk about race? Is it a conversation you have? And he says, well, yeah, we make Asian jokes a lot, like about people in computer science. And I say, okay, well, does it ever, you know, you play along with it, but does it get to a point where it bothers you? And he says, well, no, you know, if they thought I was offended, they wouldn't do it. And I say, I push him and I say, but maybe, you know, sometimes things are playful and then you do become, things get a little too personal. And he says, that doesn't happen. And he says, but it's a positive stereotype, so I don't see why I would be bothered by this positive stereotype. And then I ask him to explain, and he says, well, you know, of course, Asians need to be smart, get all the A's, and they're good at math. We have to do a lot of homework and study all the time. So in his interview, he's adding support, you know, for the stereotype. And then finally, perpetuation of the model minority stereotype. So each of my respondents throughout and repeatedly perpetuated the stereotype. It's not clear that they, you know, knew that they were doing this. And in fact, when I asked them, are you aware of the model minority stereotype, none of them said that they had heard that term, except for one whose older sister had written a term paper about it in college. So for example, Trudy says, I think I pulled my first all-nighter in third grade. And she expresses feeling a lot of guilt for missing a deadline in school as a young child. Finn goes on to say that, and he repeatedly mispronounces the term academic. So he says, my dad has always been an academiac. He has a PhD. Ever since I was a little kid, I always told myself I was going to get a PhD. So yeah, he's quite the academiac. So I ask him, how long ago did you know you were going to get a PhD? And he says, oh, ever since I've been 7, I knew I was going to go to grad school. He cites his extracurricular activity was policy debate when he was in high school. And he goes on to say he wants a big contribution to the field. And then he gives his last name with the chin amplifier or the chin effect, some sort of invention. He goes on, I also plan on saving the world, he says. Then he explains how. He says, I haven't done enough in my field of study yet. At this point, when I'm talking to him, he is a freshman. And then he goes on to say that things have been good at Virginia Tech, and he's proud of it, but that he hopes to go to a place with a bigger name for graduate school. And so that's something that I heard a number of my respondents say, is that their parents had been disappointed that Virginia Tech is where they went. They'd actually wanted them to go to an Ivy League school or to University of Virginia. And so then respondents would say, but I've got big surprises for my parents. I've been accepted to UVA Medical School, or I'm going to get my MBA at UVA. So while things were fine at Tech and they seemed proud of it, they assured me that they had even brighter things in their future. Okay, so going back to the hypotheses I set forward, I don't find support for the first or the third, and I find moderate support for the second. So the idea that my respondents distanced themselves from the events of the crimes, and in so doing, they embraced the model minority stereotype. And so we know that Asian American studies literature says, but wait, the stereotype's detrimental to those to whom it's applied. But throughout my interviews and throughout my conversations with my respondents, they embraced this label, perhaps in the wake of the crimes. And I can't be certain that they did so purposefully or consciously, but it's a possibility to consider. So in terms of limitation, of course, sample size. I mentioned to you the challenges I faced. One of the things that you should note is when this research was conducted, now we're saturated with social media and Facebook, but I approached the IRB and I asked if I could advertise the study via Facebook, and they declined my request. So I think that many IRBs today would accept that request, but at the time, perhaps social media seemed newer or what have you. So I think that was a big challenge that I faced. So my respondents were unconcerned with the horrific events, and they didn't report experience prejudice or discrimination. And so what's significant about this is it runs counter to what I shared with you earlier about the campus climate and about what was going on in terms of community sentiment in the aftermath of both of the crimes that I've discussed. And it also runs counter to what much of Asian American studies literature says. So in summation, perhaps in order to steer my attention away from members of their racial groups involvement in crime, perhaps they showed very little interest in this and thus turned to the model minority stereotype as a way to direct attention to something more positive, a feature that's more positive and associated with their group. So directions for the future, and these are related limitations. There may be a possibility that my race and my status at the times that the interviews were taking place muddied the waters, so to speak, and maybe my respondents weren't totally forthcoming with to me simply because I was a white female and I was a graduate student at the time and I had taught several classes on campus, and so perhaps they thought they were just giving me the answers that I wanted to hear. That's a possibility. Also, another related possibility is that the context of the interview impacted their responses. And so Virginia Tech is kind of a commanding school. All of the interviews took place on campus in places that kind of supported and reaffirmed the space of the university and support for the university. So perhaps had I conducted the interviews when they were back home over the summer, or in more private settings, or at a coffee shop off of campus, maybe there would be less of a focus of this institutional power that was that was present in the places that I interviewed them. And so I talked to them in the library, in the student center, and in one case, you know, outside on a park bench, but still always on campus. And then finally, considering the crimes with other school shootings perpetrated by racial minorities. So there are several Asian American school shooters, Wayne Lowe, for example, Hamad Memon at Discovery Middle School, one which you probably haven't heard much about because he was a juvenile at the time. I also am interested in talking to Asian American graduate students and Asian graduate students. Maybe they have a different story to tell. And then a theme that came through a number of times in my interviews, when I would ask my respondents if they were, did you ever consider not coming back to tech after the crimes happened? They all said, well, no, I knew I was going to come back. But my parents and or my grandparents back home said, you simply can't go back. It's going to be too hostile for you there. But they did come back. And then finally, how does U.S. and international media coverage compare to the two crimes? So I want to now bring us up to the book that we're here to focus on today. And so this project influenced my interest in Asian American and criminal justice involvement. And so we're interested in this project from a number of angles. And so I'm going to let Nicholas take it from here and talk about the book and its organization and then go into detail about his chapter.
A few things to point out. We have the forward contributor in our presence. Carol penned the forward. So when we get to the question and answer, I would like to hear her thoughts too, because she offers a lot of insight and did a fabulous job. Another thing to explain is the convention we use, the slash, as opposed to a hyphen, or as opposed to nothing, or as opposed to a PETA. Why would we call it Asian Americans with a slash? And that is from Palumbo Lau's work. And we use it to be inclusive because some of the cases involve folks who are international Asian. And so it's a complex concept to convey. And so we adopted his usage of the backslash. for instance, I'm Korean adopted. So, you know, I'm part of this heterogeneous, diverse population. So we thought that would be a good way to use. The book, in terms of the organizations, there are three parts. It's on the screen for you to see. Part one, when the model minority becomes a criminal threat. And I'm going to speak to a chapter that I wrote that Daisy alluded to about Eldo Kim and Bosung Shim, which appears in part one. Part two, model minorities and victims of crime. And part three, Asian Americans and unjust criminal justice practices. A few things to set the stage, and I'm gonna start here and then I'll come back to this slide. So my work in terms of how did we come to be partners, collaborators, co-editors in this project, Daisy and I had done previous work around model minority stereotype. there's a book, Killing the Model Minority Stereotype, that I edited, and she was a contributing author. So that brought us together in the sense of a common interest in the model minority stereotype. I, for one, have really dedicated my young career to the study of the model minority stereotype, in particular its application to Asian / hyphen Americans. And so the Model Minority Stereotype Project is something that I've been continually updating. It's on my website, you can look at it, nicholashartlep.com. But there is essentially a growing list of all of the work heretofore on the model minority stereotype. and so when the opportunity presented itself, I was very much interested, and I was interested because given that I've looked at the model minority stereotype from different angles, I want new, fresh perspectives, new theoretical insights into it. Daisy talked about the racial threat thesis, which has been used in some studies on the model minority stereotype, right? This idea that when the majority the group in power will change the rules to maintain its power, right? And so the application beyond the black-white binary for Asian Americans is incredibly important, especially given our demographic shifts that are occurring. But so when the opportunity about deviance presented itself, I was thoroughly interested. And so some recent statistics on Asian American criminal justice involvement is important to help us think about this. So approximately 10,000 Asian American offenders are in prison. Asian Americans are one of the fastest growing segments of the prison population. Incarceration rates for Asian Americans have quadrupled in the past 10 years. 42 of the approximately 3,251 inmates currently on death row in the US are Asian American. And the first person in the US to be executed via gas chamber was Asian American defendant Gi John. Many of you, I'm sure, have seen the Netflix documentary 13th. And Michelle Alexander's work and the new Jim Crow and others' important work is featured in that. And that's important history to consider. But I don't recall Asian Americans really being part of that discussion. And we are part of that. And so thinking about Dr. Ball came up with the title, which I think is brilliant, you know, the model minority as victim and perpetrator. So we're not just passive recipients of aggression and racism and violence. We perpetuate it symbolically, real terms, right? Murder, homicide, victimless crime, et cetera. So to me, this is part of this work that I'm alluding to of trying to extend this model minority stereotype in different spaces. And to ask questions. So before I dive into my chapter, I want to point out that, as Daisy mentioned, the New York Times Magazine story that William Peterson penned, it's now technically the 51st, but I've guest edited a special issue that will be out soon on the 50th anniversary of the mono minority stereotype. And in that work, authors have looked at the model minority stereotype in different lenses, theoretical lenses, so post-colonial lens. And in this project, I would say we have a diverse contributor list, but through communication studies. And so when we think about agenda setting theory, that was a theory that I really wasn't keyed in on. I actually was talking with a former doc student of mine who had his master's degree in communication studies and knew a lot about this, cultivation theory, all of these different theories. So I want to jump to the Eldo Kim chapter and point out, so Daisy has talked about Virginia Tech and Cho, who's Korean. The case that I'm adopted Korean, I'm going to share about Eldo Kim and Bosung Shim, who were and are both Korean. So not to just pick on Koreans today, but it just happened to be coincidental. So I am going to read a few things verbatim from it because I don't want to be verbose and absent-minded and forget things. So I just would like to be very crystal clear because you in the audience, I've been there, right? It's hard if people aren't on point. So the case of Eldo Kim. Eldo Kim was scheduled to take his 9 o'clock a.m. Government 1368 Politics of American Education final exam at Harvard University on December 16, 2013. According to special agent with the Federal Bureau of Investigation Thomas M. Dalton's affidavit, motivated by a desire to avoid a final exam, Kim emailed a bomb hoax to 5 or 6 Harvard University email addresses. At 8:30 a.m., the subject line of his email was, "Bombs placed around campus," and the body of the email read as follows: "Shrapnel bombs placed in Science Center, Seaver Hall, Emerson Hall, Thayer Hall. 2/4. Guess correctly. Be quick, for they will go off soon." At the time of his crime, Kim was a 20-year-old sophomore at Harvard. Dalton's affidavit requested that the court issue a complaint charging Eldo Kim with violation of 18 U.S.C. And 18 U.S.C. refers to a criminal violation. Whoever engages in any conduct with intent to convey false or misleading information under circumstances where such information may reasonably be believed and where such information indicates that an activity has taken, is taking, or will take place. In Kim's case, no one died or was bodily harmed as a result of his email bomb hoax. So he was eligible to be fined under this title or imprisoned not more than 5 years or both. And so in my chapter, I talk about this incident, Eldo Kim, a Korean Harvard undergraduate, 20 years old. And I contrast it with another Korean man, Bosung Shim. And Bosung Shim was a student who attempted to hack into the system that hosts the MCAT scores for medical school. He was a prospective and aspiring medical student. And in the comparisons and the contrasting of the two cases, they both were younger Korean men born in Korea and immigrated to the United States. Both had parents who were highly educated. Kim's father was a professor in Korea, and Shim, the gentleman who attempted to hack into the medical school system, his parents were physicians. Both attended elite schools. Shim had graduated from the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, which is considered to be a public Ivy, and Harvard being an Ivy. And so there's a lot of similarities, but the differences that I found were a few. One was that many more case stories were written about Eldo Kim, whether that be the Crimson, the Harvard newspaper, student newspaper, or mainstream, the Washington Post, New York Times. Much more was written about Eldo Kim's bomb hoax compared to Bosung Shim's hacking case. Eldo Kim got a pretrial diversion, which essentially means, right, you won't have a felony on your record. You have to do a few things. You might have to do community service. You might have to pay a fine, right? And he also was allowed to possibly re-matriculate at Harvard, meaning you were excused from Harvard, but you may come back and actually get a degree conferred. Shim, on the other hand, didn't get a pre-trial diversion and did serve some jail time, some prison time. So the concept of part one, when the model minority becomes a criminal threat. I mean, what was it about Bosung Shim's actions and misdeeds caused him to be viewed more pessimistically, where he was reviled, where Kim was revered? I mean, many things about the Kim story are interesting in terms of the commentary. People on blog posts would comment, well, you know, his father had passed recently, and so he's under immense amount of stress. Final exams at Harvard, you know. But that meta-narrative, right, what the meta-narrative says is important, but also what counter-narratives say is important. So some people said, well, you know, that government course, that's kind of an easy gimme course at Harvard. Like, everyone knew, like, you'll get an A or a B, but look, it's not a high-stakes class, right? Kim wrote an apology. And in that apology, he said, look, I've made a mistake. I was tired. I had gone like 3 days with minimal rest. I should have, it was a mistake of the heart, not the head, or a head, not the heart, right? That no one got hurt, etc. And pretrial diversion plans are commonly given for bomb threats. Like, there are other people, white, black, Asian, people who have made bomb threats and they've gotten pretrial diversion. So I'm not trying to say that Kim's case, right, he should have gone to jail, etc. But I'm complicating the idea that one person had done a cyber crime, right? Bomb threat via email. Tried to cover his tracks, right? Through covering his IP address and all that. But ultimately, it was discovered because he used Wi-Fi, right? But then the other is a cybercrime of literally trying to change the test score of his MCAT score. Shim had taken the test like 5 or 6 times earlier and simply didn't have the score necessary. Now, I don't think Shim will be able to go and get admitted to a medical school now that he's a felon. But yet, Eldo Kim possibly could finish with a degree from Harvard. Now, I want to share something about, because this project, to me, I enjoy working on book projects because there's an intimacy level that an article doesn't provide. And when this book, the cast of contributors is diverse. So we have sociologists, we have communication studies, we have grad students, we have faculty, senior faculty, junior faculty. But one thing that stood out to me was this research, this project, when I was attempting to write the story, which Daisy provided me really immense feedback on my rewrites, was that challenging. I felt like a journalist, I really did. Because when I attempted to corroborate facts, right? Reading affidavits. What did the FBI say? What did the newspaper say? What did blogs say? What was factual and what was afactual? I came across a pressure inside as a Korean man to get the story right, which we always should, right, as researchers. But it was like, well, you know, I need to ask, the only person that can answer that question is Eldo Kim himself, right? Like directly involved. And so I went to Facebook and I just put in Eldo Kim. And sure enough, there was one Eldo Kim. Yeah. And I said, out of the blue, I just messaged him. He didn't have his privacy, whatever. So the gentleman responded. I don't know if he's the real Eldo Kim. But his responses seem to suggest he was. And these are some of his messages that came back to me. They're there for you to read, and I'll address them. But what was very interesting, and I'm trying to be empathetic, right? If you make a huge mistake like that, that's devastating, right? I mean, and I'm sure he's very remorseful. But it was interesting that when I approached and asked him and I said, introduce who I am, this is the purpose of reaching out, my condolences to your father, right? My sister had died a summer, right? So I feel bereavement, right? If a family member, I can only imagine how he feels. But he immediately thought that I was attempting to prey upon his story and get rich. By the way, selling these books, we don't get rich anyways. But and so in the heat of the moment, he really felt like he was being cornered. And that was not my intent. You know, you have them, it says right here, I have absolutely no incentive or obligation to help a stranger poke into what is an incredibly intimate and personal story. Definitely. I totally understand that. If you want to gather up news stories to generate academic conclusions without even understanding 1% of anything, then go for it. You know, that wasn't the attempt of the book. Painful stories, that doesn't mean they're off limits as researchers. I mean, this was a very important story to talk about. I don't plan on looking at it. Now, that's the ironic thing. It's a paradox to me because I would want to get the story right, but he's unwilling to even read, or at least this gentleman who responded to me. This is your project, not mine. You know, the bottom left corner, to confirm your facts about what? Anything about me that you can get is available publicly. True. Otherwise, it's personal. Okay, that could be true, but some of the stuff that is publicly in the public domain isn't, when you look at different sources, the sources don't match exactly. And that's important. A year makes a difference. Is it the third year of the death of your father or the fourth year? That's important. Is it the second year, right? The times, I mean, so there's a constellation, of facts that I wanted to get right. And I felt obligated to. And lastly, What's disrespectful from my point of view are people who want to further their careers by using the stories of others' traumatic and complicated experiences without even considering how it affects them and their loved ones. Well, you know, the irony is we don't know how it has affected Eldo Kim. I know that how it's affected me as a Korean man. I know how it's affected me that the Virginia Tech shooter was Korean, and I announced to someone, or they learn of my ethnicity and race. They're, oh, you're Korean. Oh, do you know that Virginia Tech guy? You know what I mean? And so, but we don't know intimately how it's impacted Eldo. The last thing I'd like to share is when I went back, when I was putting together our slides, I went back into my messenger, and the Eldo Kim name was changed to Bobby Kim. So there's another reason I do think that it was him. I don't know. If he's watching, please reach out to me. And so what I wanted to share that with you, because this project, I feel, is part of work ongoing that I think is important work. You know, the statistics that we share here and in the book, what they reveal is super important, but what they're concealing is almost more important. What hasn't been said that needs to be said, and how do we even know what needs to be said if no one has said it? And so this work has been really a launch pad into work now that I'm doing with LGBTQ Asian Americans, and some of my work with endowed chairs who are Asian American. We have, in the field of education, we have very few Asian American endowed professors. I was just on my social media, two more African American professors got endowed gigs. One is Mark Gooden, he's coming to Columbia here in New York. He's going to be. So what I'm trying to say is I'm not starting a race war of, oh, well, blacks got two endowed, where are the Asians? But it's important to see why aren't we being represented and where are we represented? And so what, in conclusion, I'd just like to say this project has been part of this puzzle that I've put together, or I'm putting together. I see it. It becomes clear each and every day. So that's why it's really important to hear Daisy's perspective on the work that built up to the work, and then kind of how we've come together for the project, and now actually how Daisy is working with on the book on endowed professors who are Asian Americans. So that's all I have to.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So what questions? Yes. Okay.
Like, I was wondering, the shooter Cho.
Yes.
As you mentioned, I remember this because it's been 8 to 10 years ago, hasn't it?
Yeah, the 10th anniversary is this year.
Mm-hmm. And was there any explanation why he did it? Was he on the medication? Did he have social issues in the past and he attributed to the family? Have a perspective on why it was done?
Yeah, so the way that it was framed by the media, and the explanation, as I understand it, of the family is that he had extreme social anxiety and had been mocked and harassed essentially throughout his academic career in academic settings. And he had seen several mental health counselors at the university, but it's believed that they dropped the ball essentially. And so he wasn't given the treatment that he needed. But yet again, it was framed. I mean, I think what's interesting is had he been of a different racial background, this might have been framed as a thug committing a crime or a terrorism crime or what have you. But what we find is that oftentimes when whites and when Asians commit crimes, it's explained by individualistic reasons, i.e. they suffered from a mental health problem, or it was just this one person who went crazy. Similarly, the person who committed the beheading, it was explained that, oh, he just snapped, he was under financial pressure, it was, you know, a love situation, that a love triangle that broke down. So that's the understanding of the Cho case at this point. But because he did commit suicide, you know, we're not able to hear from his perspective, although he did leave the manifesto. In the manifesto, his explanation was that he hated all of these rich white kids at Virginia Tech with their liquor and their cognac and driving their Mercedes. But then sadly, many of the people that he killed were racial minorities and from a diverse background.
Was Cho, was he he an only child? Was he?
No, he had a sister who was at Harvard, I believe, and so a very highly achieving sister.
And a lot of the cases, too, would you agree, Daisy? Yeah. I know it's been a while since we've looked at it, but that a lot of the mental health was certainly in white supremacy, but mental health was a lot of the cases we talk about, the violent cases and the murder cases, were male assault, males who committed the crimes. Again, you know, women a lot of times. But there was a lot that involved mental health needs unmet, and also would you say like romance, because you
yes.
talked about that, like a romance, or I don't know how to describe it.
Yeah, and I mean, with Cho, one of the things he'd gotten in trouble for before the mass shooting was for taking photos of girls in his classes surreptitiously with his phone. And so some had come and said, you know, I don't feel comfortable with him being in my class anymore. And at that point, he had been kicked out of a class and had been hooked up with a professor just to do an independent study in place of coming to class because he had made women in the classroom feel so uncomfortable. But yeah, I mean, as far as I know, all the Asian American, well, but this is a trend with school shooters, there are very few females.
Yeah.
So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
And we had written a piece for Joe Fagan's blog about Dylan Root, or the gentleman in Santa Barbara, mm-hmm. who was essentially
Elliot Rodger,
upset that he hadn't had sex with all these women, and then he just went on a rampage. So what I'm trying to say is a lot of misogyny mm-hmm. is involved. And that's something I'm interested in as Asian American male, right? Is it this heteronormative, this hegemonic masculinity? Like, I need to be macho and violent against women, you know? And how does that look as an Asian American man compared to a white man or a black man? Mm-hmm. Carol, can you talk about? Because you did a phenomenal job in the foreword. To talk about your history and your work, because I learned a lot from that.
Mm-hmm. I probably was one of the earliest Chinese crime reporter in the city. Started, I think, probably around 1987. In the beginning, I demand that I need a desk at the police plaza and also in the federal in Manhattan and also in the federal criminal court. So I was putting, I was allowed to go into the press room and then I was given a desk and that's where it starts. So basically learn crime reporting for all the reporters from Daily News, from the New York Times, and also from other newspapers. Mm-hmm. Many people who work in this type of work graduated rather fast because so-called metropolitan desk, pretty much you do it for 3 months and you move on to other area. So it's there are some old criminal reporters, you know, that very, very famous, mm-hmm. Like Daily News and also New York Times. So, but I stayed there for 6 years. So I'm mm-hmm. probably the oldest one still remain in a metropolitan desk for 6 years, which is a very long career for a crime reporter in the city. Yeah.
And you had covered some of the RICO cases.
Cases that I covered that have a long-lasting effect on Asian American community is two RICO cases. It's a racketeering case. One is the United Bamboo case, Julian Bond's case, and then another one is the Green Dragon case, that is Fujian, Fujian Bond. So these two cases are rather interesting and also involve huge amount of so-called city or federal cleaning up of New York City is a Chinatown. So that was, and after that, I moved into a different profession. I become a teacher, and now I teach at City College. So. Mm-hmm.
So when it comes to the cases like you mentioned, whether it's the hacker or the school shooters, and they end up being Asian Americans, I actually don't hear about it a lot in terms of, well, in the news or, you know, what articles or blog posts people can put up about those kinds of events. So what has, like, in your experiences, what has the response been from Asian American communities when something like this does happen and an Asian American is the perpetrator of this crime? Is there a response, or is this something that we're still learning about?
Well, Daisy and I are putting together a project about Peter Ling, the police officer case. And so, I mean, how do you think that response, or what did you, have you seen in terms of the response where it's like a community member did kill someone as it relates to...
Literally only saw one Facebook about it.
Sure.
It was from the news, and it was, I think, like, with his case, they were talking about how he was one of the first officers who was actually indicted for killing someone. Whereas there are a lot of other officers of different ethnicities who weren't.
Sure.
Right. And that's literally all I know. I don't know.
Well, I think it's related. My response, and I'm sure Daisy could respond too in her way. My response is, so the model minority stereotype in the literature, a lot has been, right, it's divisive, it divides and conquers, and it takes our eye off white supremacy and, you know, racial threat thesis. But that's what I mean in the sense of, okay, we need to move beyond that into more nuanced and more complicated ways to explain these phenomenon. So for instance, well, what does it look like and why would Asian Americans embrace this problematic stereotype? Willingly or unwillingly, knowingly or unknowingly, through a post-colonial lens. For instance, Liang, you're right, he was the first. So was he scapegoated? Probably. Was he used as but then at the bottom, at the end of it too, right, how does it fit within the Black Lives Matter movement? And he did murder someone, and the documents that I've read, you know, he had his finger on the trigger, he shouldn't have, right? Their trained officers are on the side, right, of, you know, trigger pull tests were done, it wasn't a faulty gun. You know, these are these complicated and unsettling stories that we might say as the Asian American community, and I know it's very broad and diverse, that he does deserve to go to jail, or he committed a crime. Others would say, no, well, why are we cherry picking here? Look at these police officers. So, I mean, the answer isn't so direct, but that's how I would answer your response, your original question.
Yeah, and so I would say that taking the Virginia Tech case as an example, I think that what's significant is how quiet the Asian American community was in the aftermath of that. If we look at the Black Lives Matter movement, if things had been said about the Black community, for example, on campus, as they were said about the Asian community, I believe there would have been much more of a response. Related to that, my difficulty in recruiting participants for the study, for example, if today I were to go to a campus and say to African American students, would you be interviewed about race relations and crime right now, or race in the Trump era? I think that there would be a lot of people interested in partaking in the study, whereas I got to the point of feeling I was being almost too pushy trying to get people to speak with me about my project. So, and the Asian American community has a history of being quite quiet following crime. The Vincent Chin case is one in which there was an audible response, but it did fade relatively quickly.
Oh, did you? You had a question too before we.
Yes.
Yeah.
I don't remember what my question was. So my question was to Daisy, actually, to ask whether you had any intentions of extending your research to other campuses. For example, in New York City, we have the CUNY system, and Baruch College, let's say, has a large Asian student body. And I remember a few years back, there was an incident where there were a group that were on a trip. They were all part of a Greek society.
Yeah.
I forget what it was, but there was an initiation going on, and one of the members passed away during that trip, and they tried to cover it up. So it's very interesting to think about schools like Baruch, where there's a large student body comprised of Asians or Asian Americans, and how within the Asian community we are also perpetuating these myths, distancing from each other, because there are people who participate, who we place labels on each other in the Asian American community, and I think we have labels for people who participate in Greek life. Mm-hmm. We have labels for people who participate in other parts of campus culture. So I think that's a very interesting area to explore, how we within the community on a campus like Baruch perpetuate these stereotypes.
Yeah, certainly. So one project that's currently underway that I'm working on related to this is so much of the literature looks at Asian Americans at top-tier colleges. They're very selective, competitive colleges. And so there's very little on Asian Americans studying at relatively non-selective schools. So I'm interviewing, in-depth interviews with Asian Americans at what I refer to as non-elite or relatively non-selective. I'm still trying to figure out exactly what term to use so it doesn't sound derogatory, but just typical state schools. To see what it means, how the model minority stereotype might play out differently in those academic settings than in more Ivy League or more elite settings. And what I'm finding, what I'm hearing from people, is that they're embracing their Asian American label, and they are particularly kind of proud to be seen as the academic superstar in the class. And this is not what you read in much of the literature on Asian American studies. But yeah, then I'm also conducting a content analysis of graffiti now on the 10th anniversary of the shooting to see if there will be commemoration on certainly, and to see if the response or the story that the graffiti tells is different or similar to what I found earlier. So,
and related to the Greek life, those initiations and deaths, I have a forthcoming article that looks at adopted Asian Americans and through a student affairs lens. Right, of how can campuses, we have affinity groups like Asian American, we have the Asian American Club, or we have the Black African American Club, right, to support services. But what does it look like for someone who's phenotypically, you appear like you're Asian, right, but inside you've been raised by white people as an adoptee? Maybe you don't speak the language, you don't know anything about food, you don't identify, you don't know what K-pop is, right, you don't do anything remotely, right? And you want to go into Greek life, which tends to be a white space. And then you get rejected, like, right, they pick on you and tease you, ridicule you, and then you come back and you're like, oh, well, maybe you need, and then, right, the student affairs, we put you into the Asian club. But then there, in that space, you don't. And I think it's kind of like this cisgenderness or cisracialness of, like, well, what is your race and how do you identify, how do you feel inside? Right, so this transgender piece, like, okay, well, you look like you're a boy, so I'm gonna put you in the boy club, but you might not feel right. Mm-hmm. And it's related because depending on who we're talking about under this umbrella, Asian Americans, and the labeling theory, is there are some people who, like Daisy said, might be very proud to embody the model minority myth, like, yes, I am, right? And they might not see, so the optics of it might be one way, but they have no idea that it's problematic on other levels. And so I think that's the complication that we need to take to this work. When we say Asian American, most of us immediately probably have a mental image, but we need to understand that that population is incredibly diverse. And we've really focused as social scientists on one population and done a poor job of capturing the diversity and the nuances. Mm-hmm. So you had a question.
Hi. What do you make of, I guess for lack of a better term, like of the students, Asian American students' denial of racism? Because that was something that occurred so frequently in your interviews. They're like,
right.
Oh, yeah, I've never experienced racism, and you know, as an Asian American, I did not feel comfortable saying, like, yeah, I've, like, people have just said really racist things about me until I got to college.
Interesting.
But in high school, where I went through a predominantly white high school, I would just be like, oh, they're just joking around. It's just a small little thing. And then my friend, who's a Black American woman, she was in class, and professor, who is Asian, and an Asian student got into this conversation, and the Asian student was like, oh, I've never experienced racism. Mm-hmm. So what do you, like, how would you unpack that, like, there are so many young people, young Asian American students who are saying...
Who are making that claim.
Yeah, who are making that claim, like, oh, I never experienced racism.
So, I mean, maybe my respondents and the person you're mentioning hadn't gotten to the point, unlike you, where they had found their voice, so to speak, in college. So maybe they hadn't reached that point. Like you say, you were in high school, you were like, oh no, nothing's happening. But then when you got to college, you had the ability, or you had the point to acknowledge it. So I think that's one possibility. Another possibility is, as I mentioned earlier, maybe I wasn't making them comfortable enough, and or they didn't feel as though either that was the answer that I wanted, and they felt as though they needed to give me the right answer to the test, or what have you, because of my role, or perhaps I hadn't established enough confidence in kind of my listening to them for them to be more forthcoming with that, then another possibility is fear that then the conversation would go towards the Asian American as criminal threat, and so there was much more comfort just directing it towards model minority type things, and along with that denial of any sort of problem. I think related to that is the idea that for members of this population that I spoke with, members of my sample, being Asian American and being a Hokie is working for them. And they're having really positive outcomes. They have high GPAs, they're going on to high level programs for grad school. And so therefore, not that it's conscious, but it might be detrimental to their group's success to acknowledge that there's an issue. So, thanks.
And related to your question, I'm a millennial myself, I'm in my 30s. And the work of racism, modern racism now, the work of Bonilla Silva, sociologist, Ian Haney Lopez, we use coded racial appeals, oftentimes dog whistle politics. So when we're talking about race, we're not. When we're talking about race, then, or when we're not talking about it, then we are. And so it's almost this absence presence, and this this notion that young people, Bonilla Silva's work, has found that young folks are more adept at race talk than older people, which suggests that young people feel that at times could easily be tricked to deceived that, oh, I haven't really experienced racism. So the way that race has kind of shifted into culture, like you can talk about things culturally without being accused of being racist. And so how we are kind of color mute is important consideration with this, as well as, if folks don't know what a microaggression is, right? So they might not have a language to understand, well, if you feel this way or you've experienced this, that was in fact racist, and here is why. Mm-hmm. Because typically we think, racism is more aggressive acts, right, of like certain words, epithets, certain actions like violence, hanging people. Whereas now in modern society or more contemporary times, racism is much more mercurial, so it's hard to pin down because of the way we talk about it.
I got a comment. Hey, Nicholas, Tom Kaplan. How are you?
Hey, how's it going?
We've been chatting on for a while, and finally got a chance to meet. I do appreciate, Daisy, your comments as a researcher, and the comfortableness of that.
Yeah.
I think it is spot on in a certain sense. If you're talking to an Asian American person who's, you're trying to find their identity and their race, and you're having this conversation, they may not be as comfortable. So I think that that's a component. And I think maybe the conversation would be very different if Nicholas was having that conversation.
I think so.
But also might be different because he has a very white name too. So the whole aspect of it is whoever the interviewer is, you may get a different response. I also think of a situation when I was growing up, a lot of times I did a lot of self-declaration joking.
Yeah.
I wanted to be part of so-called collective group. I grew up in Long Island, which was wanted to be white and kind of fit in. Mm-hmm. As I've gotten older, this whole racial and ethnic identity actually the light switch went on. At mm-hmm. what time is typically probably in college. But I knew it was all along as a child, but I couldn't understand as I got into college, because a lot of the rejection on part of the so-called white community, I didn't really have a label for it in a sense, an understanding of it. So the dynamics of it is that you wanted to fit in, but you realize you find a community as you get older, you find a certain community that you're very close to in a way, you know? So the Asian, so-called Asian American community is very mm-hmm. close in your year, but then you realize there's another layer. As a, as an adoptee myself, mm-hmm. I found an adoption group more closely aligned, you know? So I guess is that if you, and also fast forward now in today's world with the sense of more conversation about race, I wonder if there's a selective, I think, growth of understanding our own racial identity and also our ethnic identity. But being part of social media, I still recognize a lot of Asians, Asian Americans, and also Korean adoptees, they don't have that conversation. And I realize that conversation doesn't start because our parents aren't having that conversation. So if our parents are not having that conversation, how are we supposed to, when someone asks that question, what does it mean to you? What it means to us is basically working hard, you know? Or telling you, don't rock the boat. That's not what we do. What do you mean, not what we do? You know, don't speak out. So we've kind of taught certain things to be very passive about it. You know, not to be aggressive as so other minorities. And I think it's shifting a little bit. You're seeing a little bit more of so-called activism when people are speaking out that tends to be, you know, Asian Americans. And I like that shift, but it really is the shift that's going to take generations, having our kids, and not to accept the norm and not to accept, you know, being quiet and being passive.
Thank you.
And one thing that I've learned about Daisy is just her, your, again, bringing in the slash Asian Americans, about your past, the history, you know, with your father and living in Japan. And so, like, you have ties to the Asian American community in ways. And, but then, yet, you know, typically, you know, when people construct you as a white woman,
Thank you for this comment. I just related to that, so one of the ways I got the idea for this project was that when I was in graduate school, all of my roommates were Korean and Korean American men. So I rented a house and I rented rooms out in the house. And I observed the great discrimination that they faced on a regular basis. And so I thought, wonderful, I want to learn more about this community. And that's why I was so surprised to get the responses that I did. But yeah, I mean, if only I'd had a team of interviewers going out, right, Asian and non, to see maybe how the responses had differed. So, thanks.
Has there been cases in either of your careers where you've met Asians who don't agree with the microaggressions that exist, or that racism doesn't really exist? Because I'm finding that more and more, even though there are more people talking about racism and microaggressions, there are people, including people I know, who aren't Asian, but who are of other ethnicities, that feel like microaggressions are just people taking stuff personally. And if you guys have noticed that, how you guys have dealt with those kinds of situations, or what are your thoughts on that, I guess?
Yeah, I mean, I would say that at my university, for example, there's a lot of focus on microaggression, and the African American and Latino community are very vocal about this, and we have microaggression training and so on and so forth. At the same time, in the interviews I'm conducting with Asian American students, once again, they claim that they've experienced nothing racial. And I don't know, is it that they don't have the language, or they don't have the upbringing, or is it a cultural thing, right? Or we're taught not to rock the boat, we're taught not to complain, so.
My response is white fragility. White fragility. You know, it's not on us, it's on them. And if they to say, well, microaggressions are racist, and the way you're taking it is just emblematic of misunderstanding racism. I know that in the sense of I worked at a PWI, and there was a lot of white fragility going around. White tears about, like, oh, so you're calling me this? You're like, no, you just have to be aware that what you just said is a microaggression, or it's a micro-invalidation, right? D-Rod Sue, his work at Columbia, right? Microaggressions are real. It's documented. And then they can do with it. Now that I'm at a minority-serving institution, a urban minority-serving institution, everyone understands microaggressions. And in fact, a lot of the white faculty know what white fragility is. So I think it's contextual, thinking about like if you're suburban, rural, urban, and also kind of what Tom said about like adopted folks. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of adoptees who live in suburban, more racially homogenous white spaces that might have different experiences than if you're a more metropolitan mm-hmm. folk. So there's a hand in the back.
Yeah.
So when were these interviews conducted? Because you mentioned previously how older and younger generations of Asian mm-hmm. Americans are more or less vocal. Mm-hmm. And would you consider those students you interviewed to be an older generation?
Yes. What do you mean? Do you mean older in terms of like now they're more senior?
You mentioned before how the newer generations of mm-hmm. Asian Americans are more vocal about
right.
this.
Right.
And issues related to that. Yeah. So I was wondering when these interviews would be conducted, because if they're all saying, no, I've never experienced mm-hmm. racism, you know, that mindset, what era is that?
Yeah, so they were conducted in 2010 and 2011, and so I think that's a great point that, you know, across race wasn't a topic in the way that it is on college campuses today. Like, for example, at my university, we just had a Black Lives Matter teach-in, and so I know many universities are having these sorts of conversations. Related to that, the university is, or Virginia Tech is a kind of a institution to itself, i.e. it kind of rules the town. It's really, the town is the university. And so I think that certainly at that time, race was not as vocalized, or conversations about it were not as vocalized as they are today. So yeah.
Just a quick question. Is there any studies of comparison between the previous model minorities or the Jewish American folks that had mm. challenges where the Asian Americans a little different, because Jewish Americans can kind of blend in, so-called
right,
society,
yeah.
and so on and so forth. But is there a comparison? More on the comparison I'm thinking about and thinking is more the white America attitude is mm-hmm. really to embrace that culture, is not to rock the boat in a way, mm-hmm. just quietly do your thing and so on and so forth. But it becomes, like you said, it could be detrimental to other Asian Americans, so on. And not only that, you may get these wonderful degrees, but there's a next level of your career, it's mm-hmm. like called the bamboo ceiling.
Right.
The point where you have this high level education, but you are stuck in middle management, never get beyond mm-hmm. that. You know? So any research or any someone thinking of that?
Yeah, I mean, I've certainly seen that connection made in the literature. But I also want to point out, you know, we always cite Peterson's article as what created the idea of the model minority stereotype. But actually, if you read Ellen Wu, you see that it was earlier than that, and B, Asian Americans themselves helped fuel this myth, simply because in contrast to being cast as yellow peril, this was a very positive direction to be turned into or to be recast as. So,
yeah, there has the work. I mean, so there's early work that looks at the Jewish issue, but one thing that comes clear to me is the intersections of all of our social identities, but one being religion. So you have the Protestant work ethic, mm-hmm. Christian, you know, and then you have Jewish, Judeo-Christian, and so I think there's a difference. Also, then you have this notion of like Mormonism. Mormons are kind of like this model minority. Amy Chua, the Tiger Battle Hymn of Tiger Mom, her first book, but her subsequent book with her husband, Rubenfeld, looks at Mormons and I think Caribbean, you know, these other mm-hmm. groups that take on this model minority framing. And I think the nexus that we need to look at is how much success and then how much tips us to threatening. Because, you know, okay, you're okay as honorary whites, you're succeeding, that's okay. But how much success are we going to allow until you're a threat? And we see the threat evident in many behaviors at the micro level and at the macro level, in terms of housing, in terms of university matriculation, in terms of all of these institutional factors. And so, yeah, there is a historical, Asians weren't the first model minority, and perhaps they're not going to be the last. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's my response. But.
Mm-hmm. And also the silver's work mm-hmm. racism without race.
Yeah.
So that's a milestone to look at how race study, a racism study using the previous model, pretty much it's not very functional or very valid. And then we continue to use all these kind of federal survey to define whether there's racism around. So maybe the student, because after the 70s or 80s, then racial slur become really criminal. Mm-hmm. For me, you know, you cannot call somebody something mm-hmm. and then you can get away with it. So we create this very clean language, but nevertheless, something hidden behind, you could really feel it. And that's why it's racism without race. Mm-hmm. So they kind of, so that is a book, and I think it do use a very great framework mm-hmm. to analyze what we perceive in Virginia Tech, and also mm-hmm. many Asian who claim that they don't experience racism. Because language is very clean, because mm-hmm. nobody could really say something to you that is offensive in terms of using race terms. Mm-hmm. But nevertheless, you feel something, but you kind of cannot find the grounding of or kind of feeling it or respond to it.
Yeah. Well, in the Linsanity work, so there's a lot of people writing about that have written about Linsanity in a vein of this research. Anyone that knows anything about Jeremy Lin knows he's a devout Christian. He's put out many public statements, many videos about his faith as a Christian man. And Christianity maps on very well to this docile, passive, apolitical body, right, as Asian Americans, right? It's play by the rules, don't rock the boat, dress nice and be presentable, pray, right? And it feeds into more neoliberal notions of prosperity gospel, right? Like that, okay, inequality happens, like clearly you're just not working hard enough. Mm-hmm. If you just pray to God, you know, you'll get your private jet. And so that prosperity gospel maps on nicely to this passive way. I mean, how does a queer Asian man disrupt that in the physicality or the politics or the sexuality of what we deem as being this traditional, nuclear, multi-generational, prim and proper, you know, rice eating, chopstick using, fill in the blank, right? Very parochial. And so I think it is, to return to the question, it's important to look at religion and how it intersects with the stereotyping.
I think you have to take it further, because as you talk to other Jewish folks, and I was adopted by a Jewish family, mm-hmm. but wasn't raised from a Jewish perspective, but more culturally. And I think you talk to a lot of Jewish folks mm-hmm. who were raised, they weren't raised in a sense in a religious aspect, but more mm-hmm. cultural yeah. aspect. And I think that's the next generation of Asian Americans. We're mm-hmm. so-called, we're not foreigners, we're Americans, and we're raising mm-hmm. our kids to have a kind of a blended mm-hmm. culture per se, and so there's a culturalness that is there. So I think that there's a correlation amongst Jewish and Asian Americans, mm-hmm. and that correlation is losing your ethnic identity, mm-hmm. your mm-hmm. kind of your also racial identity. Jewish kind of lost, so there's a lot of so-called cross relationship or a mixing of relationship, and you see the dynamics of relationships today. The highest, you know, interracial relationships are mm-hmm. Asian females mm-hmm. with white males. Mm-hmm. There is some portion of it the other way around mm-hmm. Asian men. Mm-hmm. Why is that? Mm-hmm. It's an interesting aspect. So Kimberly and I discuss it all the time. Mm-hmm. It's my point of view. We have these racial conversations and how Asian men are perceived and Asian women are so different, you know. Mm-hmm. One is exoticized, the other ones are emasculated.
Yeah, yeah.
We're not even at the level of so-called, you know, the status of men. You know, we're very at the bottom.
But then even also, I have a difficulty when we use emasculation, that somehow to have a penis is to be manly. And then also, what does manlyhood and masculinity look like for a man, a straight, cisgendered man? Does that mean, like, you use power tools? Or right? And so I think, you're right. As a man, as a cisgendered man, adopted Korean, my wife is white, Polish. yeah, what does that look like? So endogamy and exogamy in ethnic marriage, right? And or if you're, you know, some would say, is it a strategy for upward social mobility? Like, if I'm married, maybe it's not. I don't know. I mean, I shouldn't be teasing about that, but you know. But then, like, if you go to Korea, then it's like, oh, well, it's a Park surname. We can't marry the Park, so you're the Kim family. Or, I mean, it's complicated.
I have a different approach.
Yeah, yeah.
No, for women, a little bit different.
Oh, is it?
You know, there is a, my kind of theory.
Yeah.
As Asian men, we don't get on the hierarchy of being the so-called, as Kimberly would say, the other white meat. We're still considered Asian perpetually. Mm. I think the Asian woman thinks that they'll be part of this Asian society, the so-called other white meat, but in reality, she gets stereotyped a little bit differently and perceived as maybe in New York City as being the hired help. Mm-hmm. That's the irony, is you think you're part of this collective group, mm-hmm. and next thing you know, you have these comments of saying, you know, where's the parents? Because if you have an ethnic-looking Asian child, mm-hmm. yeah, I mean a white child, yeah, yeah. which could happen, they mm-hmm. could think it's a higher help in, right. in New York City. Could
you're right.
You're
right.
About microaggression there.
Yeah.
Sure, you know? Yeah, I mean, and the media, I mean, you know, this anyone see the Great Wall, the Matt Damon? Oh my gosh, like, Lord help me, why do we need another, you know, whatever, it's crazy. Mm-hmm. Is there any other
questions? Quick presentation. Daisy, do you happen to know what was the Asian American student population in Virginia Tech?
At the moment or at the time?
At the time.
So they were the largest racial minority group, and I don't remember the exact figure, but I believe that they were 3 to 4%.
3 to 4%.
Yes.
Okay, so Nick, is a quick question. There was a slide regarding an increase in incarceration for Asian Americans. Mm-hmm. What type of crime are they looking at?
I don't have, I'd have to look at that citation, but we can talk after about that.
I'm just curious, I don't know how many times you've done this talk in the audience that you've done it, mm-hmm. I'm curious to know if you've done these talks in front of more Black or Latino audiences, mm-hmm. what's been their response to your research?
On
this research in, say, more Black or Latino audiences.
Yeah, so I would say that I haven't presented, I mean, my audience has typically been Asian American or white. Mm-hmm. At my university, I have a diverse student population, and they do, when I talk to them about my work, they do, my African American students, for example, say, oh my goodness, if we were facing this, you know, we would be rallying, and we'd love to talk to you about our strife or what have you. So that's, just anecdotally, that's the response that I've gotten, at least from my students when I discuss the project.
Yeah. I was wondering if there's any type of political relationship to any of these, you know, studies with Asians, right? If we have a more representation, say in Congress, in local government, in community, right? Would it make a difference in terms of, you know, some of this, voice, right, that's being communicated in the community, like the Peter Land case, right?
Yeah.
The fact that we do have a mask coming out, however, there is, like in New York, right, close to heart, there isn't really a organized group, if you will, right? It's more of like everybody got together and went to Borough Hall, made a big stink, right? And yeah, we have a couple of those, right? But for the most part, it didn't really do much. Mm-hmm. We didn't even get coverage, right?
So I would say it makes a difference. I mean, I would say it makes a difference. I mean, Carol just shared prior to the lecture that she's going to be playing a role, and I said, well, how many Asians prior, you know? Well, probably none, you know? I'm the first. And Daisy and I wrote an article related, but we used network theory and homophily. And so I would say that we need to, I affirm what you're saying, because I think that networks replace themselves. So if we're not there, then we're going to continue not being there. So we need to break in to this, right? And when we're there, then we can start replacing. But there again, right, systems of power will change. So let's say, for example, empirically, it was accurate that there's an Asian invasion for all elite colleges, which we know there isn't because they're concentrated at the 2 years. But let's say for a moment that was factually correct. Well, then theoretically, in a few years, more and more will replace, because, right, legacy admissions, what have you, would replace them. But we know that would never happen because the power, the system would change the rules that govern. So then, you know, white supremacy continues. What I'm trying to say is mentorship is incredibly important. Carol's been a mentor to me. Joyce has been a mentor to me. And now I will mentor other people. So the question becomes, who are we mentoring? Are we mentoring people that look like us, who come from the same backgrounds? And if not, who isn't being mentored? And maybe we need to diversify our mentor relationship. So the pipeline, I think it does. Local government, national government, academics. I think it's important. That's my response.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think so.
What is your thoughts about
we're
it?
Underrepresented, right?
Yeah.
Even the ones that we have currently in the community, mm-hmm. right, that we see that they're pretty much under the control of the bigger Democratic Party or whatever, right?
Sure.
They are in there for a purpose to join the Asian vote so mm-hmm. that they could help the other white or, mm-hmm. you know,
exploitation.
Well, mm-hmm. it wouldn't go that far, right? But so that they could get their position, mm-hmm. right? I give you a true fact. we just elected the assemblywoman, right? She is under the quote-unquote control of Scott Stringer. And because both of them are looking for higher position, right? So she's in there, got the Asian vote, right? And next thing you know, there's talks already, mm-hmm. right? That they're out there, Scott is coming out to be trying to, put a candidate to be a mayor, mm-hmm. right, against de Blasio, right? So it's unfortunate. I'm glad to see her to be in the position, but she's not flexing her muscle to mm-hmm. represent the community.
So it's almost like she's being a sycophant or some racial bourgeoisie,
yeah.
and she's not the petite. Right, she's not from the street, right, of representing. Well, they're called politicians for a reason.
Well,
left wing and right wing, they're the same bird.
Right? Yeah. You should work with the people, right? You represent the community. You should come out and, you know, fight for it.
Yeah. We know that it's expensive to run for public office. Yep.
What I would say to that comment, of course, it's important to have more elected officials that
Representative, but I think even more important is for us as a community to be able to build our power and our voice accountable. And I think, you know, even some of your comments, you know, with continued, you know, generations of Asian Americans, you know, like me and my wife were raising our kids right now, they're seven and four, right? You better damn well believe they're going to know what it is to, like, hold your elected official accountable, and they're going to know their history and Asian Americans. You have to have that. So
I think it's important for us as a community, as an Asian American community, to make sure that we teach ourselves and organize and know how to play this advocacy game and to hold people accountable. So then it actually doesn't matter who's in office. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter if the person else is an Asian American or, you know, some other race. We're going to hold you accountable for policies you want to see happen in our communities, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's even more important. And, you know, mm-hmm. hopefully over time, if folks are more engaged in that way and are more community-minded, hopefully those are the folks that will get elected into office and will be in office for the right reasons. So, I mean, I definitely think we have, you know, I mean, I talk to some other, you know, friends of mine who are in nonprofit spaces, and I say, you know, I think one of the biggest things that, you know, our community still needs is, like, leadership, right? We
mm-hmm.
need that mentorship, mm-hmm. you're mm-hmm. saying, like, we need that, you know? Now that we're here, we've been here, and we're going to stay here. Like that's our path to, you know, continued success, prosperity, and, you know, really fighting for what I think we all want. Things that are just, right?
Yeah, Zora Neale Hurston says, she's got this quote that says, like, if you're silent, right, but you're being persecuted, right, what's going to happen is the oppressors are going to be like, you enjoy what you're going through. So we can't. We got to stop being quiet. We have to voice. And we already do that. Don't get it wrong, right? We are very aggressive. But the narrative in the media would like others to believe that we aren't.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
I have
think it seems that, you know, talking about Asian American and crime, you know, as a victim or as a perpetrator, we see the prison population also increase through the years, as all these incarceration rate. And it seems like we are still lagging behind in joining dismantling the prison system
that
built the United States into such a huge incarceration population. And I think in one way, Asian population also need to look at these very invisible, extremely minority in this prison population that we currently have. And also through the treatment, I think when I interviewed one of the godfather in Chinatown, he spoke in black English, very obviously. And obviously his English was taught pretty much because he's incarcerated so much. And I was like, this is a really cross, racial story, right? And I was never had the opportunity to really talk to him more. So again, it's like, it's huge movement trying to decrease the incarcerated population through criminal justice, through all kind of advocating. But I think the Asian population or Asian community is still lacking that kind of mission, enjoying the bigger picture, like Black Lives Matter, and also, so in one way, care for those people who are incarcerated, not just their family issue, but also population, Asian population, caring for those people behind bar, behind the prisons. Sometimes you become our story because it takes so long to get to visit somebody in prison, and the family needed help, and it seems not to be organized for this yet. So again, we still have a lot of work to do in relationship with crime, and then with the prison population, and also criminal justice issues. And I hope that people through tonight's discussion will open that to care for those people who are Asian in prison.
I guess in like both of your personal experiences in general, when it comes to what an Asian American is that something like that's changing? Because I know that what I usually have to do is remind people that I'm also Asian American. I'm not from East Asia, but I am Asian American. Because I am from South Asia. So I'm wondering if that's, from your experiences, if that's something that's been changing or not. Because one interesting thing, one professor had told me that according to the US Census, I would actually more identify more correctly as white rather than Asian. And that was something that was new to me. And then I listened to this NPR podcast yesterday about the U.S. Census, and one of the things they said is that Middle Easterners actually identify as white when they check off most of the time, when they check off the boxes of whatever it is, see if they check off as white, or they may put others. So I'm wondering if, in terms of all the work you guys have done, if that's changing in terms of people's mindsets of what an Asian American is.
I think that there's increased awareness to the specific situation you're setting forth in the literature. But I'll say that even people who, we might agree are all clearly Asian American, like when I have recruited people to be in research projects that I've worked on, a number of them have contacted me and said, but I don't know if I'm Asian American enough to be in your project, or I'm Chinese American, but I was adopted. Am I an Asian American? And so my response is, how do you self-identify? That's your inclusion is simply your self-identification. But so I think that there's a lot of confusion, right, within the population, and even more with outside of it, in terms of how exactly we define our parameters. So.
Well, and also, I would hate for you to argue that you're closer to being white, because historically we know the court cases of Thind and Ogawa, like, who wanted to become white and basically was denied. And so I would say yes, affirmatively. I would concur with Daisy that there is more awareness and there's changing, you know, the language, the language that we use around it. Again, like a PETA discussions of, well, should Pacific Islanders be lumped in with this group? Yes or no? You know, and colonialism, Filipinos, right? Are they closer like Spanish, Latino? And I know they're colonized, they're Asian, you know? So I think to answer your question, yes, there is. And that's important, that evolution, the language that we, to be a more inclusive, AAPI, so we have all these acronyms. It's like alphabet soup, but that's why I said, right? We just use the slash. It's very inclusive. Yes. It's very inclusive. So, yeah. Well, thank you very much. We have some copies for discount. It's a really excellent collection. Talk with Carol. We're very honored that she'd be part of the project too. So, thank you.
Thank you all so much.